emotion, right? We as a human being can do it very well, right? And that's why we have five different cognition, you know, indriya, right? So different elements of cognition, and using that, we can do this cognition very well. Now, as you might have heard in the first place, like, we want to replace human being. I don't need human, you know, for even for the cognition part, right? So can machine interpret, understand every difference, whether it's happy, whether it's sad with our service or not, and react accordingly, right? If machine has to do similarly, then it also has to understand the sentiment, the intent of a person, and accordingly you should react to it. It's not an easy problem. It's a very, very hard problem. You know, we have many emotions, and it's not a binary, zero or one. It's more than binary. And also, when Vivek talked about context, right? Unless we understand the context, we probably will be making mistakes and reacting to a situation. For a machine, if they make a mistake, you know, it would be a disastrous conditions. To address all these conditions, that's why researcher, both in academia and industry, is putting so much effort on understanding, and you must be hearing a lot about cognitive intelligence, cognitions, and etc. a lot nowadays. And all these techniques, like, you know, deep learning based techniques, and, you know, traditional NLP, vision, and textual analysis, all these techniques are actually helping us to achieve those kind of accuracy. So my talk today would be on those lines. I'm not sure, you know, by what time this would be up. Is it up? No? Yeah. Only thing is the demo I will not be able to, but so. So any questions so far? No, not much, right? All right. How do you name this bot? How do you call it? This
Alexa.
Bot?
Alexa.
Is this Alexa?
Alexa. Okay. Is Alexa.
Oh, I see. Sure. So, I don't know how many of you have already seen this, you know, cute bot already, interacted with it, right? All of you. Yeah. What do you think? Like, how is it reacting to you, right? You know, when you ask, like, can you do something for me, it's able to say, look into the web, figure out what information you are searching for or asking for, and able to, you know, get that and convert back to you in the form of a speech and, you know, answer to you. So this all are happening because of the fact it first understood what you are asking, then it understood that you have an intent of such information. So then it has to go to the web. So it also has some knowledge by itself, and says, look, I don't have that knowledge that that person is asking for. I have to go to web and look for the right information, right? And then it fetched all the information, and then it convert that in the form of, you know, like using NLG techniques, some of the data or information which it can interpret back or manifest back to you, converted that and, you know, spoken to you back, right? This all process happened at the back. You know, it seems like a magic, but, you know, this all happened, and it's all happened by your machine. Now, in today's world, you know, when we talk about cognitive intelligence, we broadly talk about several different departments of it, right? In the morning, we saw a demo of recommender system. Recommender system falls under, say, this part, information retrieval. There are different parts of it, right? One part is, how do I understand what to recommend? I need to know the knowledge. So that knowledge part comes under information extraction and then modeling. Then, you know, given that knowledge I have, how do I interpret back? And then what knowledge I should additionally get in order to answer question, that comes under information retrieval. Machine translation comes with the fact that, you know, if today you are using, you know, Google Translate, right? Most of us are using. Say, for example, I use a native language, I want to get it converted to Hindi, even English. So I use machine translation. This all happens because of the fact the Google understand this language is not English and looks like, you know, what it is talking about, there is a corresponding corpora in English. It figures these two are similar and then accordingly translates and give it back to you, right? So this all happens. It's not a word-to-word translation, but it's like a full paragraph-to-paragraph translation which is happening using machine. That's called machine translation. And then the whole sweet world of question answering, you know, Vivek talked about, you know, given information, how to convert one part, then given converted information, think about the same financial example. What if I now have the whole financial, you know, knowledge converted in the form of a text? Now, how do I interact with that? Can I now ask question to it? Can I get answer to it, right, from it? So all these chatbot and etc. is falling under question answering part, right? Right. Now, this is a very sweet, and this is the fundamental of the knowledge and cognition, right? You see the pyramid. The basic of it is the data, right? So at the end of the day, what you have is data, and rest of all the other pieces are interpretation of the data, right? Data would be transformed to information, then information to knowledge, and knowledge to wisdom, right? The silver lining, we want to reach wisdom, like I want to make machine really, really not dumb, but really intelligent. That's what we are trying to build, you know, intelligent machine, which, you know, having enough wisdom to react to different situation, condition, understand every signal, you know, it gathers from environment and reacts to it. But we are far from it, right? We have not reached, you know, even 1% to that. But what we have reached, are able to reach, is at least data information and information to knowledge. So this piece, in today's talk, we'll talk about this. I will not touch wisdom because I do not know how to do it at this point of time. But no one in this at this point of time know how to achieve wisdom using yet, you know, machine. But, you know, I'll not, you know, passively comment here, because that's exactly what all of us as a scientist are trying to achieve, that, you know, wisdom to make system more wiser, but we are not yet there, right? So these are a few of the example when you talk about the transformation, right? Data to information, knowledge, and so on and so forth. So all the pieces, like all the different use cases that we have in hand today, fall under any of these, right? One is data transformation. Say, for example, I have a given data, so I give you a whole news. I want what? I want a summary of it, right? I don't want to go through the whole news, but a summary of it. I give you the whole financial of a company. I mean, I don't have time to go through the whole financial, but I want to invest on that company. Can I pass through the whole financial and get a specific action points out of the data? So again, there what I'm trying to do is I want to summarize, I'm converting one form of data to another form of data, a data transformation, right? Big data to smaller data, which is much more concise. Then there is also, say for example, I have whole social data, like all unstructured data from social network. From there, I say for example, a business, if I have to react to certain signal coming from social data, say for example, I want to invest on a company ABC. However, from I don't have that information that how it is performing within my, say for example, my internal database. What I want to do is I want to build a reactive system so that today there is a news about this company is acquiring another company, and that's a good news because I can now invest on that company because I know that their financial is obviously good, and that's why they could acquire a new company. So I have to react to that, so that point, and I want to invest on that so that my return is, you know, is multifold. So there what I'm trying to do is I want to capture all this information coming from unstructured data, social data, news data, etc., and to convert that back to a structured data which is similar to my, like one of the table, one of the column in my table, so that based on that my downstream other application can make action. Like if I'm doing algorithmic trading, like algorithm decides when to trade, when not to trade, when to buy a share, not to buy a share, can now react to that kind of signal, right? So that's, there is a whole stream of work around how to make unstructured data convert to structured data and accordingly react. Then this information retrieval, as I talked before, right? All this recommender system, query insight, that falls under information retrieval, where information to information conversion. There is no conversion, like I ask for information, I get information back. The best information that's possible with respect to what I have asked, right? And then the whole world of knowledge management, given the information that I have, which I've got from data, how do I capture in my ecosystem so that later on I can reuse, the whole reuse purpose coming into the picture. And that's why people started, you know, Google has built the biggest knowledge graph for the world, so that based on that it can understand, you know, how you are related to your friend, or how your query is similar to similar query who is sitting at the Silicon Valley, and then how it can figures out what would be your intent, information seeking intent, right? When you search something in the Google search bar. So all these, they're capturing the form of an ontology, like global knowledge graph, that falls under knowledge management. And then the final is the extraction, right? Say for example, now I have all the information scattered across everywhere. Now how I can extract information when asked for it, and can effectively answer to certain question, like even in the form of a Google query and so on and so forth. So without spending much, why I spent a little bit more time there, because these are fundamental. Later on, whatever I'll be talking about, I'll be talking about all these use cases, right, somewhere. So, you know, whenever someone talks about NLP layers, you know, you're trying to build as a company, or when you'll be learning about NLP as a student. So think about NLP is not something which people are using it. It's basically an enabler for something else. It's a middle layer. So you have information, data, and you have users on the other side. And NLP sits in between so that it can help user to get information the most efficient way. That's it. NLP, the main work is to do that, right? You have information, which is not NLP, and you have user, obviously they are not NLP, user could be anyone. And you have NLP in middleware, which will enable user to get information in the most efficient way, right? That's the job of NLP, right? Now, when NLP has a plethora of different systems, one he talked about NLG is one, one part of NLP system. There are other two bigger part, which is NLU, natural language understanding, and the bigger gamut of NLP other techniques, which may or may not fall under NLU, right? So if NLP is the bigger umbrella, then you have NLU, you also have NLG, and then you have other part, which is speech, which I will not be talking about in here. So whatever I'll be talking about in today's lecture is only about the textual format, like natural language in text, not the voice. Okay. So if you have to know, since you do not know NLP, I'll touch a little bit about some of the fundamentals of NLP, like at least, you know, at the end of the day, when you go out of this class, your friends will be talking to you and then say, okay, I know NLP by 1%, right? So that, to make sure that, to do that justification, because I spend money and come here, I wanted to give you that much information, okay? So the first thing that we do in NLP is parts of speech, right? There's a basic, like the way we have been trained, you know, since our childhood about a language, the same way we teach machine, right? Understand this is parts of speech, this is article, this is verb, this is preposition, so and so forth, right? Noun, so and so forth. Similar way we teach machine that these are the constructs of a sentence, right? Being in English or otherwise, these are the constructs of a sentence, and that's called parts of speech, you know, understanding. And there are certain tools, you know, someone asked for, are there some AI tools? Yes, there are tools. It's not tools, it's libraries available which will help you to tag parts of speech given a text. Post tagger, that's been called as. Now I'll not talk about parts of speech tagger because you can pretty much find it, but I'll just give you some of the signals so that at least going back home you can start searching what to do, right? Think of it, parts of speech is the first thing that you have to learn. Then chunking, right? Given the whole blob of text, can I break it down into certain sections so that my machine can understand what to look out and what to throw out. Right. Say for example, verb is something. Say for example, I'm building a reactive system. Right. As I talked about the example, right, someone is acquisition is one of the things that I'm looking out for. So acquisition is a verb, right? So it's like acquiring is a verb. Someone is acquiring another company is a verb that I have to react to. So that particular verb is something which is actionable for me, and that's why I am interested in extracting all the verbs from phrases. So chunking helps me to spot things and throw out other things, right? So mentions, people talk about in social media, nowadays I can tag at the rate, right? You can tag your friends, Facebook post. Say for example, how specifically, say for example, Facebook engine understands now I need to notify the other guy that you've been tagged. It's obviously someone has tagged it, but there is some action that he has to do it. Like, how do we prioritize the notification? The Facebook has to make a decision, like whether I should prioritize now and then send a notification to this person or not. So it does it because of the fact that some of the key words like at the rate, hashtag, all these they have put in order to make sure that the engine at the back understands, if those specific terms appear in a conversation, it's of certain importance, right? So all these are happening because of the fact there are obviously a grammar that's been set by Facebook, for example, an interpreter engine, but also the property of language is such that, it enables you to use certain kind of keywords or terms within the sentences. Then, obviously, he talked about context-free languages. If you have a language, you need to parse those languages, right? So the parser is very, very important. Like any parser, our brain is nothing but a parser, like which understands, how we are conversing with each other, and then it parses, figures out what we're trying to talk to each other and like what we're conveying. And all this happens also by your machine using the same mechanism, right? That's called, grammar parsing, right? You parse a sentence, figure out what is what, their dependency, their distance, and based on that, you react or understand the intent behind any conversation, right? Co-reference, that's fine, but another thing is named entity recognition, right? So this is another very, very important topic in NLP. What happens is, like, given a blob of text, right? As I talked about name, How do I react to it, right? Now say for example, what is named entity? Typically named entities are nothing but nouns. Now we talked about verb before. It's very important also to understand the noun, because say for example, if someone is talking about, Shaudip likes to eat apple. Shaudip likes apple, say for example. Right. Now if this is a sentence, there are two nouns, one is Shaudip obviously, and the other is apple, right? Now given this sentence, if a machine has to react to, first it has to understand whether this apple is fruit apple or apple, right? So which one, right? So first it has to understand there is a term called apple being used in the sentence, and then apple in this context looks like Shaudip. The previous sentence was Shaudip is a data scientist, and then he's talking about apple. Probably this is a system which is apple, right? So the context is important, but as also it's important understanding what is noun and which noun it's talking about given the context, right? What is the meaning of that noun in that context? And that's the reason why named entity recognition is very important. As you can see here, right, we talked about Neil Armstrong and his location. So all these are basically nothing but named entity. So that's very, very important for any reactive or any system to act upon, right? So to make a reactive system, it's as important as verb, noun, right? Okay. Now, when we build a NLP system, a few things that we take into consideration. First thing is pre-processing. Someone talked about morning. He talked about that. We just throw information to the system, and my team members believe that deep learning will take care of it. But I'm old school, and that's why I do a little bit of cleaning before sending it. So that cleaning is nothing but pre-processing, right? Now, say for example, when you'll be building, as a student, you'll be building something. Someone's talking about, I want to build system which can understand sentiments of, students, right? Now, say for example, you want to build a system. It's not about only your class student. You want to build a system which will go to, say, Twitter and figure out any candidate who has suicidal tendency, right? Trying to convey something which relates to suicidal tendency. Now what you are going to do is there will be a lot of folks who will be talking about things which probably sounds like suicidal but not, right? So for example, someone's talking about I like to drink beer till the last breath, right? It might not be, right? It might be just like, I love beer, but I'm a drunkard, right? So, and that's why, but this is, the death has been not been used for showing suicidal tendency. Now, this could be a noise, but if I take that into my training set and I build my whole system is erroneous. So it's very, very important for you to understand what to take as a signal and what to throw as a noise. Sometimes this happens that you need a domain expert to do this text processing, behavioral scientist, for example, in your case. And sometimes it could be something which pretty much you can use some system in order to figure out what is not, what is not. There are techniques also, clustering techniques to figure out what is not noise, and so on and so forth. Right? But keep that in mind, that text pre-processing is very important in order to make sure your model is not bad. Then you do a little bit of language engineering. It's nothing but whatever I talked about, the chunking, blah, blah, blah. All these are coming under text language engineering. Then the concept relationship, which is nothing but the grammar we talked about, the dependency parsing we talked about, all this comes under that. And then final is the, if you want to build something, like say for example, either you will build a chatbot, then information retrieval, search, and so on and so forth, right? All these are applications of it. Now, I wanted to show a demo of it, like a summarization, but today, because the system did not work, it's okay. I can share the quote with you, like, since you guys are students, you can try at home. So I'll not touch upon that. I actually wanted to show you that, you know, I'm not talking vague, but actually when you build a summarizer using NLP and machine learning technique, which the initial text was like 72 you know, phrases, sentence, which using a graph-based method, you could really reduce to two sentence you know, summary. The whole financial statement became two sentence summary, which the rest of was all blah, 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 and then there were two most important sentences in the whole corpus. So that kind of ability you can get, you know, using NLP, using in other techniques of NLP and ML, obviously. And that's why, you know, researchers like us are spending time, you know, taking the, you know, that part forward. Now, you know, assume that you have seen that, and, you know, now we talked about the basics or fundamentals of NLP. Now let's see where in enterprise like ours or theirs or anywhere, like in industry, how NLP has been used, right? Which are the areas which has been used. So as we talked about, right, so the cognition is, again, an intermediate process where you have one side information, another side knowledge. Cognition helps you to acquire that knowledge by, you know, you, so say for example, this is the human, you have information seeking intent, you want to gather information or knowledge. So you have in between the cognitive process or all the machineries which helps you to gather knowledge from the other side, right? That's the process of cognition. So this is what we have learned so far. What if the new challenge is, what if we want to flip the coin, right? Right, say for example, it's about a trend. What if I want to do, you know, first, so the whatever conversation I'm doing here or whatever I'm talking about, how can I, you know, convert that to a knowledge? Like this is information going from the here to there, but how about information going from here to there? Can I flip the coin, right? Yes, we can flip the coin. And that's the new challenge which we are solving, you know, and whatever, you know, we'll be talking about now on would be the other side, right? How can I get all the information that's generated by human being and put it in knowledge base rather than just getting the knowledge base from here, right? So knowledge from back end and then provide to the user. So this is, you know, putting everything into perspective. We talked about NLU, so the typical architecture of any NLP pipeline, where you have NLU, NLP all together, NLG as well. So you have messaging background, so this is the interface. So the moment you start conversing, there is a broker which figures out whether you are asking for information which it does not have to send to backend and can, you know, reply back, or it has to send something to backend. And then it interprets. If it figures out it has to send something at the backend, then it goes through, the whole information goes through machine learning layer, which is basically NLP, NLU, and decision engine. And then decision engine makes a decision whether some information has to be invoked, retrieved from the backend and to be shown to the user. NLG has been used to convert that information to a conversation, and that conversation, whenever the conversation process happens, like is complete, then that manifestation of text would be converted back to the user, again via messaging backend. Like chatbot, we talk about chatbot, we talk about you know, other search engine, search-based conversational agent, all having the same architecture. This is the same architecture for everyone. Search engine, voice-based, Alexa, same architecture. Google Home, same architecture. All having the same architecture. This is the architecture, right? It's little detailed architecture, don't go here, but you know, only look into that side. You know, any conversational agent works with three things. One is NLU, and then entity recognition. So entity identification is nothing but a you know, sub, not sub, I would say the output of NLU. And then the response generation, nothing but what you have seen in the previous lecture, NLG. Now, give an example of what should be an output of an NLU module, right? Say, for example, what happens is my objective is to figure out, given a whole text, like given that I've said, Alexa, find out all information about IEEE SAKEC, right? So I have asked this question to Alexa. Now, Alexa figured out, you know, find all information, right? So it's someone is asking about information. So information seeking intent. So that's an intent about whom IEEE SAKEC, right? So about a named entity which is SAKEC, right? Information seeking intent and for an entity which is your college, right? And who is asking? It's Shawdeep, right? So he's understanding, etc. So all these come into play in order to retrieve information for the backend. So that's what is happening from the backend side, right? So as you can see here in this example, how can I retrieve list of customers who have birthday this month? Retrieve is something which is the user's intent, which is retrieval, information retrieval. List of customers is an entity, customer list, and who have birthday in this month is another criteria, which is date month. So these three goes to the backend like a SQL query, find out, select star, whatever, where intent equals to retrieval, entity equals to customer list, and entity criteria equals to date time. So that's exactly converted to that format and then hits web to figure out all the information that's relevant, that's matching those criterias, and retrieve been retrieved back. Right? There are different, you know, way of doing it. People do this identification in different way. One is called retrieval model, retrieval based model, where, as I talked about, right, this SQL query, I go search and get back. So it's pretty much like there is a template, SQL-like language exists, there's a grammar exists by which I go hit information, get retrieve information, and show to the user. So if you have to build a chatbot, there are different languages, open source, which enable you to use similar kind of grammar or whatever you can say to enable this kind of retrieval model. That's called conversation model. So chat script, go and look for this kind of language, right? At least chat script, the open source, you can use it pretty much. But these are not scalable, right? As he said, like template-based model is not scalable, like, you know, like that. For NLU also, these are template-based model, it's not scalable. The scalable model is obviously deep learning-based model, where there is no script at the back, there is no template at the back. What I know is I give to the system millions of questions and their corresponding answers, and go and figure out what, if the question was of this type, answer was that type, and so on and so forth, right? Similar question, dissimilar questions, and the machine will understand, given that question type, what was the answer, given the sub-question, what was the answer, and so on and so forth. And that's what we called as encoder. The question was an encoded intent, and decoder, the reply or the answer was a decoded version of the expression's answer to the question. So, and then in between, what you have is a thought vector, which actually attaches the question intent to the answer expression. That's it. That's the model that we have, right? So that's called generative model. This is a scalable model. You know, since you know, now I don't have to templatize everything on the world and then come up with a model, but you know, pretty much I throw input and output and say figure out how the connection between input and output happens. This is nothing but what is captured in a model, encoder decoder model like this. You know, there are, you know, very very famous encoder decoder model. LSTM is one of these. You know, people are using. I mean, Facebook uses it and others uses it. But you know, keep this in mind. Facebook could use it because of the fact they have enough data. Google can use it in Google Allo because they have enough data of the world. But you know, when I try to you know build it, it will not work because I don't have enough data. So you start with something which is very very naive and simple, like what I've shown in the first, and have the intent that over time I'll build something like this, because that's not scalable. This is scalable. You have to, you know, keep track of whatever I'm showing to the user, how they are reacting to it, and based on all of this you create all these logs, and on those logs you build eventually a model like this, right, which is scalable. And I'm not touching NLG because he has already covered all of this. Now, now I'll give you a few of the example of conversational agent we talk about. So why do we, again, in enterprise, why do we need conversational agent? Because of the fact that in enterprise, the main problem is, you know, we have too much of data and most of the data is not searchable because of the fact, you know, data in the form of email, data in the form of invoice, you know, PDFs, text, all of these exist in an enterprise and everywhere, in fact also in enterprise, and all this information are important. Say for example, I'm making a decision about whether I should purchase a specific, you know, say for example, Alexa device or not, but probably some of my department has already purchased it. But that purchase order in the form of a text, you know, it's not been scanned and etc., digitized, you know. It's important for me, my financial team, to understand what is happening everywhere, right? So is there any way by which I can get that information? Some other department has procured it already. But that's only possible if the data is discoverable, but currently it's not because it's in the form of a different format, which is other than which I can discover. It's not digitized. It's not on the web. It's not on, you know, hosted somewhere. To make it happen, what we call this kind of data as hidden or dark data. And most of us currently working towards making this dark data discoverable. And this is, and all the search technology currently, we talked about deep web, and how do we inform, how do we figure out information from deep web and so on and so forth. Basically, how do we figure out information which are residing in data source which is not discoverable at this point of time. Now, the search industry is also moving in a different way. So cognition is also coming inside search. So we previously used to write, type, and then search. Now you also use image to search. And we are using voice for searching. The next level is we will not use anything, but our expression will talk about what we're trying to search and accordingly figured out from the back end side. So yeah, so it sounds fascinating, but it's happening. There are you know, institute in UK working on a project called brain computer interface, where they put, you know, low end fMRI machine on your brain to understand what you're trying to think, and accordingly the machine reacts, you know, understands your intent and accordingly reacts, you know that intent could be information seeking intent or otherwise. So this is where we are moving towards, you know. Not to get worried, like, yeah, but still we are far, we have not reached there, but we have reached cognitive search, like that part, right? You know, some of the example of cognitive search we'll talk about here. You know, chatbot obviously is one of the cognitive search techniques. So this is a typical architecture of a chatbot. You have interface, you have NLU engine, you have dialogue management system, and you have knowledge base, I mean, database or knowledge base at the back. User interacts, engine interprets what's the intent of the user, dialogue management system figures out whether I should retrieve something from the back, if yes, yeah, then it figures out with the intent and entity, as we talked about the template based, right, the intent and entity, it hits back the data source in the form of a SQL, say for example, query, get the information, that information gets interpreted back in the form of a natural language generation model and shown to the user. So this is a typical flow and design of a chatbot. End-to-end, there are other techniques like the way Vivek showed, you know, people have built something called no more dashboard, but you know, can I interact with the dashboard, right? So can I talk to it, to my dashboard? That's called cognitive search of AI on BI, where structured data have been converted to unstructured data and then that unstructured data converted back to in the form of a conversation, and now user can react to that, I mean, understand that better. You know, so it can answer business question, which is intuitive and concise in manner. You know, business can ask specific question about their business, can understand better the health of the business using an ability or a tool like that. Again, a typical engine for that is, you know, like the way you talk to Google Home or Alexa, speech to text is the first module, then NLU engine figures out the intent, then information, if where the information resides, then you know, either visualization in the form of a dashboard, like if I ask a question and visual on dashboard, you can do that, or if I ask a question, get the answer back from Alexa, then that information has to be converted back to text, and then that text again converted to speech, and then speech would be shown to, I mean, would be given to Alexa or Google Homes, and would be manifested to the user in the form of text. I'll stop here. So what we have seen in today's session, or we have understood in today's session, is AI, you know, people feel that AI, I can feel, you know, everybody is talking about AI, right? AI is invisible, so it's intelligence, it's not something which we can feel and touch, it's not easy. So as a student, you need to understand that if you want to be an expert in AI, and if you want to write AI scientist, you need to know a few more things which are not, you cannot even touch, feel, right? That's even more difficult. But you know, if you do things properly, like for example, there are a few fundamentals of AI, like NLP, machine learning. If you do that, that means you are there. You know what AI means, right? So AI is invisible, and as an industry, what we're moving is we're saying that AI should not be something which I always have to see and feel it, right? People used to do it, the closest feel is visualize. Can I visualize it, right? It's not. You know, probably the best UI is no UI. And that's why Google has come with Google Home, right? I don't want to interface, I don't want to see. Because, you know, seeing through information, skimming through information is still difficult. Easier ways to converse with it, right? So it's like natural instinct, I can converse. Like the machine is not able to converse back, and that's the reason we are compromising with visual. But what if we make the machine that intelligent, that it can understand, it can feel, it can touch like a human being, then I don't need to only see it, like in the form of the closest approximation of dashboard, right? You know, but at least I can react to it like the way we do it with human beings, right? So voice, and that's the reason voice, text, gesture are all important cues which industry, technology trying to interpret and react to it. And yeah, so other thing is, you know, we talked about behavioral science, we talked about, you know, some things. AI plus UX, behavioral science is the next in. And as a student, I would say, like, you know, don't, you know, most often what we think, like, if I have to be an AI scientist, AI researcher, I just need to know techniques. That's wrong. If you miss the end goal of AI tool, right? Finally, you are going to build something which will be used by user, or to solve a problem, or to get something useful, right? If you lose sight of that, you will not build anything. You will build a box which is not useful, right? So AI UX, why it's important? It's like UX will give you an understanding of, am I using these techniques, am I going to solve someone's problem, and what's going on, when, what is the problem, what is the crux of the problem, the human element of it, right? That's the major piece of AI. Like, can I solve some of the problem which is unsolvable at this point of time? So as a student, well, you'll be knowing this technique, but also you need to figure out, you know, for what I'm going to use this and how I can help someone in order to achieve their goal by enabling them to do something using techniques like NLP, machine learning, and so on and so forth. So this is important, and that's the reason I actually put this in this slide. I knew that this audience is student, and that's why don't lose focus on human when we'll be building AI system. Although it's counterintuitive, we talked about, I want to, you know, replace all human, but don't lose sight of human being while we're building a machine which would be able to replace human. Right. With that, I'll stop here, and if you have any question, please feel free to ask. Right. Oh, by the way, so I'm not a chief data scientist only, but I'm also a CEO of a company, small company. I know we are forming inside Fractal, eugenie.ai. I put AI, it sounds cliche, but yeah, it's an AI tool, AI product. I'm looking out for lead product engineer and senior UX engineer. So if you happen to know any of your friends who are looking for some job, please do refer. Yeah, with this, I'll stop here and take a question. Thank you. No, so it's wrong to say there's no pre-processing. Obviously, there is pre-processing, but the pre-processing is not the output of it too much dependent on the pre-processing. The fact that saying that, okay, as a matter of fact, in real world, there would be noise, and the system has to know how to deal with the noise. And that's the intuition that they have. Like, now they're saying that, okay, I don't need to do pre-processing because of the fact that if I do the distribution, obviously the noise would not be as much as the signal. So it would balance out. But in real world, there would be noise, and that's why it's better to have noise. Otherwise, you will lose sight of the noise data. So they don't do pre-processing exhaustively. But that's, again, an ideal world. And that's the reason why most of the generative environment, although they also learn noise very well, but what happens is the accuracy goes down. Because, you know, in the training phase, you also put noise inside. But, you know, also he talked about the active learning system. So they said, okay, I'll make it available. And then, you know, based on how people are reacting, I'll adjust later on. So the answer is yes and no. You know, ideally, you keep everything together. But for all realistic purpose to achieve the accuracy, still they do a little bit of processing, noise removal, etc. What is the base language? It depends, like, what kind of skill set you have already available in India and also for your team. Python is, I mean, so far for data science is the lovable language because of the fact the development time would reduce 1/4 compared to Java. It's very, you know, lightweight tool, I mean, language to learn. But say, for example, nowadays, if you are really doing very heavy lifting data processing work, like say for example, you are really talking about IoT data and et cetera, Python is also not that tuned. Moving to Scala, people are now moving to Scala for, you know, big data processing. But Python Scala is just like, you know, if you know these two languages, that should be fine. Lisp, out of date. Unless you are doing a mainframe and etc., at least you don't use anymore.
Maybe others are not able to hear you.
I don't know if you have microphone.
Hello.
Yeah.
My question is how to build domain-specific corpus. Can you recommend some techniques? Because most of the corpus are already available. But if, say, for example, for financial institutes, say I'm supposed to check the sentiment analysis for a credit card, which is launched recently, but there is no corpus available in the market. So is there any way to build a customized corpus for the firm?
Yeah, customized corpus, anyway, it's there, but that's too expensive to build. So, you know, from technology perspective, there is some, technique called transfer learning. So it's like you learn from a similar domain, and then you transfer. So you know the mapping of this domain to that domain, and then using that, you transfer the knowledge that. So at the end of the day, knowledge remains same. That's also the machine translation analogy. So that okay, all languages are doing the same, right? So the conversation is like interpreting intent in the form of a language. Now, if I take a parallel corpus like English and Hindi, talking about the same thing, then more or less the language is just like a manifestation of the intent. If I extract from the language the intent and intent, I can match parallelly different languages, right? Similar way, people say that, okay, I have a domain-specific language, a domain-specific corpora. I don't have domain-specific for others, but like if I extract the knowledge out of it, like that knowledge can be transferred to the other domain as well. But accuracy is still under question. Like 70 to 80 is the maximum that we have got with transfer learning. That's a bigger problem in transfer learning. But building a domain corpus is a tough job if you can do it very well. So that's why people started using ontology for different domains. It's not that you create a corpus, but you create a knowledge base for a specific domain. So domain specific ontology is much easier task than domain specific corpus creation. Corpus creation, how do you do it anyway? I don't know. You need to know which domain you are collecting the corpus, and then you have to use people like, you know, either domain expert or, you know, outsource to crowdsource, and then, you know, label, take out what is not relevant and so on. So that's a very hard and very hectic job to do it. So
thank
all
you.
Practical purposes, very, very tough. Ontology? Sorry? Can you
hello?
Use, please, the mic?
Thank you. What's the best technique right now to do a AI-based or NLP-based processing?
Base technique?
I mean, is it neural networks, deep learning, or?
So neural network is something which everybody is talking about, but based or not based, I'm not sure. But like depending on which domain you are applying, right? Someone talked about it today morning. He talked about WordVec, which I have used. I got very decent results. So I actually replaced a lot of otherwise non-neural network-based model via WordVec. Something, but you know, if you're building something where for which you have enough data, use deep learning. So if you want to use it, obviously, TensorFlow is one Google open source library that you can use it. That's pretty much. I mean, that's good. That's good one. Gensim is another one you can get in Python. All of these are, by the way, TensorFlow has also Java version, but Gensim you have only in Python. Then you have NLTK, typically used for all NLP based techniques. So that's Python.
Sorry, please repeat.
NLTK.
NLTK.
And then you have some tool from CMU, Carnegie Mellon, on NLP. So that's also a very good one for post tagger. All these that I have shown before. For that, some library, open source library from CMU.
So I had a question regarding, so I am very passionate about NLP and all these things you were talking about. So initially I thought that, the base language, so I am not a computer science engineer or something. So I had an economics background. If like last 2.5-3 years I've been working as a data scientist, primarily in R. So and I wanted to move to Python basically and do NLP and all those chatbots and all. But currently where I'm working, they are using IBM Watson services.
Mm.
And I don't know, I mean, like, if in Watson, I mean, like, you can do NLU, NLC, text classification and all these things in chatbots using assistant and all, where you just require the domain knowledge. You don't require any coding. So what's your take on that? I mean, like,
you want me to compete with
I was very passionate about doing it in open source and developing it using TensorFlow, XYZ in Python. So, but right now, I mean, like, without knowing coding, just having domain knowledge, you can get this, you know, because most of the time when I've worked in my life, I mean, like, Fractal, I understand, we also have a, you know, one of our colleagues is working there from SPJ. So, I mean, I understand you are codely into, basically into analytics, but sometimes it
data
happens
science.
You're working in a bank. And
not analytics, data science.
Data science. So sometimes it happens that you're working with a business person and they want this outcome, right?
Correct.
It's a data science problem, but...
I'm trying to understand your question. So you want to do data
so,
science?
So my question to you is that, what do you take about IBM Watson services? I mean, like...
I cannot comment about their platform. That's not also fair. Although I'm an ex-IBMer. But IBM is definitely a good company. You know, IBM Research, I was part of IBM Research, so I know folks who have built Watson should be good. Now, if you say that, okay, does it give you all the flexibility to build what you want to build? Obviously, no, because that's a commercial product. It's not tuned for your need, right? And that's why IBM Consulting, IBM Services exist to make it fine-tuned for you. Now, this is on the contrary, I don't want to talk about IBM. Say, for example, if you want to build something by yourself, there are enough material exist over the web. Yeah, there are enough people with goodwill and put videos like this will go on web, and people, students will be able to get benefit out of it. Like, if we want to build something, there is, you know, at this stage of the world, information is enough available everywhere. So it's like our intent whether we want to build it or not. You know, you can really build a chatbot by yourself, you know, not more than in more than 30 days. It's not a rocket science anymore. And all material available over internet.
Thank you.
And still, if you're not able to find out, email me, I'll help you.
Thank you.
We had. So now, ladies and gentlemen, since morning we have been exposed to a number of technologies, a wide spectrum. We have got about AI, what are the the wide kind of 360 degree view you might have got about the AI, what AI all about, what are the opportunities are there, how the techniques has been used, and how these folks who are coming from the industry building up the system they have built, and they are coming up with the exciting new features, right, recommender systems we have seen this session. So now we are coming up with, let's have a trivia, a quiz. So let's, we will try to gauge how much attentive you are since you have been attending the session since morning. And we have some exciting goodies for you guys. So I have one question. Since morning, we have been exposed to so many speakers who have delivered the session. So the one question I would like to ask you, so anybody, you have to raise your hands, don't answer your question, raise your hands, I'll invite you on stage, and if I get, somebody would have nailed it or hit the bullseye, we'll give you one goodies, right? So are you ready, guys? Are you ready? Yes or no?
Yes.
Brilliant. So the question is, who coined the term data scientist? Okay, so many hands are raising. Let's start with you, white shirt, please come. You have to come on stage and you have to tell. Okay, yes, please tell.
DJ
Patil. And there is another guy as well, not the one guy. Please come.
Jeff
Hammerbatch is the full name, right. Please, can we have a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen? What's her name? Give the mic to him. Yep. What's your name? Yeah.
My name is Gaurav Sharma.
Gaurav.
Yeah.
So can we have a round of applause to Gaurav? So Gaurav, this is for you. Rajeshri, could you please? Thank you, Gaurav. Okay, so with this, we'll be moving on to our next talk. So we'll be having one more question, I believe. So be ready, guys, for after the sessions. So next, we have with us on board Dr. Shamsuddin. So he is a researcher and a consultant, also the adjunct professor at Aegis. His area of research is computer vision. And so today only he'll be talking about computer vision, and also he takes up the machine learning as well. So may I please invite on stage Dr. Shamsuddin? Can we have a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen? Thank you.
Okay, good evening, everyone. Well, it's late in the evening, so I'll try to keep it short and cover the aspects that are important at a high level. I'm Dr. Shamsuddin, so I am affiliated with Aegis as an adjunct professor, and I'm a researcher and a consultant. I primarily work with computer vision and machine learning. What I'll do in this talk, computer vision is a very broad area and a very vast area. So I'll try to share a perspective in this conversation, in this presentation, which I have gathered from the industry experts, from the leading researchers, and try to add some of the perspectives that I have developed based on my work. So I'll also take a look at, I'll also take a historical look in addition to looking at the current trends as well as what we can expect in the near future in computer vision. So with this we start. Here is the outline for today's talk. We'll see what computer vision is, try to understand it with respect to human vision, the challenges that we have or what we face, although the challenges have changed over a period of time, over decades as things have evolved. We'll see how we can develop a computer vision pipeline, what are the different approaches that can be taken. Again, a lot of content, but I'll be covering at a very high level. We'll see the current state of computer vision with deep learning at its core, some of the important concepts which we call as 3 R's of computer vision, what's next, and what are the current applications of computer vision that are prevailing around. So what comes to mind when we talk about computer vision? You know, we have a lot of movies which try to depict what the ultimate computer vision is going to be, right? It's about cognition. It's about visual recognition. So we have already seen movies like Terminator. There are many other sci-fi movies as well which try to comprehend what machine vision or computer vision could be, and how it could emulate or could be at par with what human vision is. Yeah, but although that is what we ultimately want to have, but probably we are not there as yet. So what we have now? So what the way we define computer vision is the ability of the computers to see and interpret what they see. So the computers look at things, and then they have to interpret what they have seen. For example, in this image, you see there is an object that is seen by a computer. And then from that object, a lot of inference is being made. For example, what is the shape of the object? What is the color of the object? What is the texture of the object? What are the illumination conditions which is actually having impact on the color which is being seen by the machine? Another way to look at this is from pixels to perception. So when an image is captured, everyone captures images, everyone takes selfie, but have you ever thought how the image is actually stored on a device? You know, we look at the size of the image, we look at the resolution of the images, but each image is actually, you can say, an array or a matrix of pixels. And each pixel actually stores the color information. It could be a 3-channel or a 4-channel image. So all we have in computers is this matrix of numbers. And how do we translate that? How do we translate those numbers into some sort of semantic knowledge, semantic information? So for example, let's say I have a picture of tiger here. How do I make sense? How do I perceive that image from those pixel values, from the numeric values that I have stored on the device? So ultimately what we want to do is we want to segment out, or we want to label what are the different objects which are present in the image. We want to segment those objects out, not only label, but also figure out where exactly those objects are. Maybe also do some sort of fine tuning, fine labeling of those objects. Well, computer vision is easy, right? Seemingly easy problem. Many of us did believe that it was an easy problem, because as humans, we can easily perceive what we see. We can make sense of what is happening when we look at an image, or we look at an object, or we look at some event. For example, if I am looking at an individual whom I might have seen many years ago, I'm still able to recollect and many times associate a name which I had known a few years ago when I had met him. But this is hard for computers. Why is it hard? So this is an example of a hard image. For us, it is still easy to perceive that, okay, there is a dog on a surface which looks similar, has a similar texture as the dog has. But imagine this picture being stored on a computer and the computer inferring that there is a dog on a surface which has texture similar to that of the dog. So computer vision is hard. I mentioned some of these things, that ultimately image is a set of pixels. So how do you go from a raw image to understand the semantics behind the image? How do you find objects? How do you detect relationship between objects? Let's say, for example, an object is on a table or is under the table. So you want to establish the relationships between the objects as well, because that forms a part of cognition. And once I know what the objects are, how do I represent those objects so that they can be used later for some Q&A or for some applications such as searching? So before we look at CV, let's quickly look at our human brain and its capabilities. This would be a very naive effort to say what our human brain can do, but human brain is amazing. What literature tells us that 30 to 50% of human brain's processing capability is devoted to visual processing, because we continuously keep on taking visuals all throughout the day. Although we may be talking, we may not be talking, we may be doing conversations, but our human brain is continuously taking these visual inputs. So a major part of our human brain is dedicated to visual processing. And it is smart. Because the brain has evolved over a period of billions of years, so it has evolved, it has learned a lot. Another important aspect of human brain is that it has lots and lots of neurons. So neurons are these basic building blocks of human brains, and there are billions of the order of billions of neurons in the brain, and each of these neurons are connected to several thousand neurons through which the learning happens. So, an understanding right now is that the learning happens because of the connections between the neurons. So if you see then that many number of neurons and each neuron being connected to about thousands of neurons, that means so many, a mammoth number of connections which are there in the human brain. And in fact, the visual processing capabilities of a child of a toddler, in fact, is very brilliant. So when the child is born, he's born with some capabilities, but due to the experimentations that the child does, for example, when you put the child in a crib, he'll touch things around, he'll try to hear the sound, try to relate to light colors, colors of different objects, and those experiments are actually helping him build the visual cognition capabilities. So here are some perspectives on early years challenges. I'm not going to go into all those details, but in early vision, the problems that we could solve or the methods that could be taken to solve were limited by the availability of the hardware. So imagine 1980s or 1990s, wherein if you have to solve a computer vision problem, you did not have enough computing power, you did not have enough storage space. So the approaches which were selected at that point of time were basically tuned to the capabilities or the experimental capabilities which were available at that point of time. Gradually, we know that based on Moore's law, there has been steady progress in computing capabilities, computing power, storage capacity, and then the algorithms or the real ways in which the researchers wanted to solve the problem, they have taken up those methods. By 1990s, you know, there were basically two main strands. So we were looking at geometry reconstruction, that is constructing the 3D shape of the object from different images. So you capture the image, multiple images of an object, and then you try to build a 3D model out of it. And then we had made great strides using neural networks to detect faces in image. And that's where, you know, the face recognition technology became a commercialized commodity. Coming back to artificial intelligence, we can summarize or we can portray artificial intelligence, the relationship between computer vision and artificial intelligence, as computer vision being a subset of artificial intelligence. So the goal, or we can say the grand objective which was set by the AI community, was can computers do what humans can do? Can we mimic what the human brain can do? So that's the perspective. Now, let's say if I have to build a typical computer vision problem solution or an application, what are the essential steps that would be involved in building an application? So first and the foremost part is image acquisition. So you need to acquire images. There are different range of types of sensors which are available, starting from RGB cameras, from the mobile cameras that we have, the range cameras which can capture the depth, the ultrasonic cameras, the radars which capture other wavelengths as well. So any image, so image does not necessarily mean only the RGB images that we see. Images basically mean any form of wavelength which can be captured and stored by a sensor. So once we have captured the image, there's a lot of pre-processing that we need to do. So the pipeline is sort of overlapping with what we saw for the NLP pipeline. So we reduce the noise. We try to reduce the noise so that we get better results. We might have to do some pre-processing to those images. So for example, if you are taking an image in a very dark dark lighting conditions, in that case, you need to do some sort of contrast enhancement, so that the task that you are trying to accomplish can be accomplished in a better manner. Post pre-processing is feature extraction. Again, similar to if you look at NLP, you can compare with word to vec as a feature for describing your documents. Similarly, images have their own features. For example, you might want to extract the lines, the edges, the interest points, the segments, the cohesive segments or blobs within the images. And then there were a lot of other feature descriptors which developed over a period of years, SIFT, SURF, HOG, histogram of oriented gradients, etc. And these features were actually used in the pipeline before we, you know, ran into deep learning. Once we have extracted the features, then we would do the high-level processing in order to accomplish the task that we want to solve. For example, we want to do pose estimation, like we want to build a stick figure of the human being, we want to build a 3D model, or we want to do image recognition, image registration, we want to detect what activity is happening, what is the event which is happening. All those things could be built once the feature is extracted. And then ultimately, that is followed by decision making. So for example, the decision making could be, the computer has recognized this image as the image of a cat, the decisioning making system would actually vet whether this is the correct recognition or not. So what have been the approaches to computer vision? Basically, the approaches to computer vision can be classified into two categories. One is biologically inspired, so wherein we are looking at neural networks which try to emulate how our brains actually work. There are artificial neural nets that we have built, but those are very fast as compared to how much time our brain neurons take to process information. But they cannot have that many large number of connections as we have in our brain. The other approach is empirical based, wherein we use a lot of machine learning techniques. So we collect a lot of data, then we feed it into a machine learning engine, and some models are built, and then those models are used for the purpose of recognition or for the purpose of indexing. Some of these models themselves are biologically inspired, but ultimately, we cannot say that we would like to go with a particular approach. Ultimately, whatever is the experimental evidence in terms of the method which performs the best is what we would want to go with. So just a quick example of a biologically inspired example of how biologically inspired computer vision processing happens. So when we capture, whenever our eyes capture an image, the image is relayed from retina to the visual cortex. And then the visual cortex has different layers of processors, you can say. So one of the initial processing happens, which is the V1 layer, is responsible to discriminate small changes in visual orientations. So it sort of identifies what are the important areas or important regions in the image, and then at what orientations they are. So this was a knowledge which the neuroscience community developed, and then that was adopted by computer vision community and was implemented. So that's where one of the feature extractor, which is called as histogram of oriented gradients. So here you can see there is a bicycle, and then when you run this feature extractor, which is called HOG, histogram of oriented gradients, you see the oriented histograms, which sort of indicate where are the edges or the prominent edges in the image. So in a sense, starting from this image, which is a set of pixels, we have now reached some sort of a representation of the image in terms of edges. And then the representations become more richer and denser as we move along higher in the hierarchy of visual perception. So let's quickly look at current state of computer vision. For that, I'll take an image. So let's say this is the image which is given to us. And what we see in this image, as a human being, we see like there are several people. There is a lady walking by. There is a lady or a person performing here with a musical instrument, sitting on a bench. Probably this person is trying to make a decision whether he wants to listen to the music. This lady seems not to be interested. And there is a lot of information in the background as well. So ideally, this is how a human being would describe, not ideally, but one of the ways in which human being can describe a given image. The current state is somewhat like this. Okay. So we can take an image, and the computer vision techniques can actually generate a description of that image. So it can also identify the corresponding objects and label them. So there's a person A walking away carrying 3 bags. So, and this is from the research, so I have not made it up. There is a reference as well. there's a person B looking at C. So now, not only, so this is the stick figure of that person, and they have also done the pose estimation. Pose estimation basically suggests in which direction the person is looking. So you can estimate where would the person be focusing on. And then there is this person C who is sitting on a bench and has an accordion in her hands. So there are rich descriptions that can now be automatically generated using computer vision based methods. If we have to describe the important aspects of computer vision, they can be, one of the ways in which they can be summarized is the three R's of vision, which is recognition, reconstruction, and reorganization. So recognition is basically wherein we attach semantic labels. So this part is wherein we are saying that, oh, there is a pair here, there is another object behind it. Whatever is there in the image, we try to assign a semantic label to it. Reconstruction is sort of the inverse graphics problem, wherein we try to create, we try to understand the phenomena that gave rise to the image which was captured. So for example, we want to understand the shape of the object, we want to understand the illumination conditions, etc. And reorganization is another word for segmentation. So we want to understand, given an image, for example this one, which pixels belong to which object and which pixels belong to which other object. So that's segmentation. The state of the art is that deep neural networks has evolved as a machinery to solve these problems. And these problems are interconnected problems. Earlier, the approach was to treat each of these problems in isolation, but now with deep neural networks, we are able to solve these problems together. Why deep learning? This is pretty much evident. We have faster computing, we have large amounts of label data. So ImageNet is a very large data set, and this actually led to a revolution using convolutional neural networks by AlexNet in 2012. So that actually revolutionized the use of deep learning in computer vision. This is another example of the current state of the art. You can see, you know, very crisp segmentations of objects and very correct labels. For example, there is a bag has a different label, so it has been identified as a different object than the human being who is carrying the bag. So is the problem really solved? So can we say that, you know, the computer vision problem is solved? But not really, because nowadays it's not more about, you know, how to use deep learning, but it's all about creating the effective or the correct architecture of deep neural network, which will help you solve the problem. So now you have to think in terms of designing the correct architecture to solve the problem. And let the DNN learn the weights. And this has been a proven approach because we have seen a lot of problems which get solved using DNN. And deeper the network, the better is the capacity of cognition. Okay, what's next? This is from a research perspective. So deep neural network and other networks that we have developed sort of simulate a type of memory that we have in our human brains. Our human brains have many different types of memories. So then there are advances that we need to make in order to try and emulate those types of memories in computer vision. So there is a feedback network architectures. So how do you bring in the context into the image so that when you are evaluating, let's say, a video stream, you are able to bring in the context so that you do correct object segmentation instead of doing an incorrect object segmentation by bringing in the context. Another thing is about reconstructing the world. There are again two different approaches. One is structure from motion, geometry based approaches, and the other one is a machine learning based approach wherein you are looking at large data sets. One of the ways is now to try and combine these two approaches to build a holistic model. Another interesting problem is understanding human behavior. So by using computer vision or deep learning, can we actually predict what would be the next move? Let's say you are playing a game, can you predict, so this would be relevant for certain games, let's say football or maybe water polo, wherein you can, looking at the person or the image of the person, let's say who is having the ball, can you figure out whom that particular player is going to pass the ball next? And this could be used in various scenarios across different domains. The last thing that we want to say about what's next, again, this is a very small or a very limited perspective, you know, that I am presenting right now. There are a lot many different things that are happening. As humans, how do we learn? So how do babies learn, for example? We don't provide them millions and zillions of images or you know, objects as input. So there is a holistic recognition or a cognition system which is inside our body, which takes into consideration inputs from different sensors, the touch sensor, the audio, the visuals, the internal motor system, and that's how the babies are actually, and they do a lot of experimentation themselves, right? So if you give baby an object, the baby is definitely going to do a lot of things with that. It doesn't know whether the object is harmful to her or not, but still it will try to do a different, a lot of different things. And that's how, although you have given very limited sample or very limited data, in this case you have given only one or few instances, the baby is able to learn and generalize. So that's where things are heading now. Can we learn from very limited data? Can we do some experimentation given the data? So can we do something with the data and then learn from it? So embodied cognition is wherein we try to bring in other aspects of cognition, language, semantic reasoning, motor control, and the human vision, the computer vision, and come up with a more holistic cognition system than what we have right now based on computer vision. So applications of CV, we know, a lot of us know and a lot of us use them. Face tagging, image search, image-based search, so video indexing, virtual reality, gaming, autonomous vehicles, surveillance, drones, a lot of applications around. Simply because we have now a lot of computing power, we have very large data sets available based on which you can build these applications. So these are very few data sets that I have, few categories of data sets that I have mentioned. There are like many such data sets available with large values against which you can build and test the correctness of the algorithm that you are building. Finally, the vision has actually commoditized, right? So we have now cloud vision. Vision is available as a service. So even though we may not know computer vision, we may still be able to consume the services offered by cloud providers, Google, AWS, Azure, and we can build a lot of apps out of it. So that's a different space, right? So everyone cannot be a researcher, everyone cannot be an app developer. But there is now this whole ecosystem which is available, which allows you to position yourself appropriately based on your interest and your skills. So these are common APIs which are available, which I found across all the three providers. And this we can easily incorporate in any application and build a strong use case around it. So I'll take this opportunity to, you know, suggest something, those who want to practice computer vision. Computer vision is actually an ever-expanding and a very quickly expanding area. So reading literature to figure out what is happening, many times it's difficult. But nowadays, what you can do is most of the community, they publish the source code. So you can take the source code, you can play around with it. Although you may not understand exactly what is happening, but still you can give it a try and see if that works out for you. The other extreme is basically you have these open frameworks and libraries. So let's say somebody who wants to get into computer vision, right? So you don't want to start from the frontiers. You want to start with the open libraries which are available. OpenCV, OpenBR, DLib, PCL, many different libraries for different types of tasks that you want to perform. So you get your hands on those libraries and you can start building applications very quickly. Although these libraries generally lag behind a couple of years from the expanding frontiers, but at least it's where you can start. So what are the insights? So I didn't put anything on this slide because I wanted to just give an analogy. So many years back, the way programming used to happen, we used to do coding in assembly languages, right? So at least I used to do that microprocessor coding. The coding, the programming has evolved over a period of years, right? So we started with probably machine language, assembly language. Then we had C, C++. We have higher order languages. We now have Python, and those are like very fourth generation or fifth generation of languages, wherein you could do a lot of things very quickly versus doing them 10 years ago. Similarly, the computer vision field has evolved. So earlier, extracting small features used to be a challenge. So you have to spend time extracting edges, points, pixels, gradients. Nowadays, you have pre-packaged solutions which can do object detection for you. So this hierarchy is just going to get more better and better. So you will have ready-made off-the-shelf solutions which will give you the basic ingredients that you want to build the app. And then these systems are going to get more intelligent. Okay, I'm going to skip some of these things. And I'll conclude with this quote from Professor Jitendra Malik. So he is one of the leading researchers in computer vision. And I'll leave it on the screen for anyone to read. So any questions in the meantime?
Thank you so much, sir. I would now like to call the head of IT department, Professor Swati Nadkarni, ma'am, to felicitate Dr. Shamsuddin with a token of her appreciation.
Thank you, Dr. Shamsuddin, for this wonderful session. So now, ladies and gentlemen, a very important announcement to all of you. So many of you, like you have mentioned, that you are working in that AI segment and you want to build your own product. So in the month of January 2019, we are coming up with a platform and an event. No talks. It's all about the applied AI component would be there. The whole idea in which there will be workshops and you'll be building up your own products. Based on these AI-based technology. And the event name is Deep Learning Summit. So if you want to come up with some ideas, you can write us. Jot down an email ID, I can tell you right away. It's Vivek, V-I-V-E-K, at bellaward.com. B-E-L-L-A-W-A-R-D. Again, I repeat, it's Vivek, V-I-V-E-K, Vivek, at the rate bellaward, B-E-L-L-A-W-A-R-D.com. Okay, so write to us. We'll give you more insights how you can apply for this. So now there's a time for a tea break, right? So we have been listening to the talk, so I believe it's a time for a tea breaker. So we'll meet, we'll resume after 15 minutes, 5:15. And after a tea break, we have a wonderful product demonstration. And this is our very own project in which we are working, and Government of India, they're also supporting us. So the product is, it's all about data science for social good. The whole theme revolves around, we have already mentioned in our first talk, that is, let's find missing child. So how we are working, how we are building up the platforms, we'll have a very fantastic demonstration. So we'll meet you after 15 minutes time. Thank you so much.